What a beautiful day, huh? Beautiful summer day. It's cool and it's going to transition to heat. Enjoy the heat the next couple days because we may not get any more heat spells. September's right ahead of us, and summer's winding down. But boy, what a beautiful summer we've had. What a beautiful day, summer day we're enjoying this morning. God's natural air conditioning. It's been nice turning the AC off and just enjoying the fresh air throughout the house. Are you guys ready to worship the Lord this morning? Amen. Remember, we're gathering not because it's about us. It's all about Him. And I hope that you're glad that you're here this morning, that you're looking forward to what it is that God has in store for us. But I got to tell you, you're not here by coincidence this morning. Amen. We serve a God of order, and the Bible tells us that the steps of a righteous man are ordered of the Lord. There is no coincidence. We serve a sovereign God. We're here on purpose this morning. God has called each and every one of us to assemble and to worship Him this morning. We're not here to consume. We're not here to get something. We're here to give glory to God, honor to God, respect to God. It's all about Him this morning, and we should be thinking about that right now. It is now time to turn our distracted hearts and our eyes toward Almighty God, Elohim, the creator of everything, heaven and earth. We are being called by God this morning to be nourished so that the very life that we have been given is for the sake of the world. We're here to be fed so that we can leave this place and go tell people about Jesus. That's why we're here this morning. We are called to worship the one true living God, the creator of heaven and earth, the savior of our souls, Jesus Christ. We must remember to exalt His greatness, His kindness, and His power. If we do not, what's it say? The rocks will cry out. And what a shame that would be. We are encouraged to corporately worship with others in the body of Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, this morning, I really wanted to read a scripture, and I really battled back and forth as to whether or not I should use this version, but I'm going to, because this is not the official reading of God's word this morning. This is God's word, though. I'm going to read from the Living Bible, but it's a passage that we're all familiar with, and we're called to forsake not the assembling. And you know what? I've really been driven to spend more time in God's word. I'm in God's word so much every day, all day long. I'm reading everything I can about God. I'm reading different versions, and I'll tell you, this particular passage really spoke to my heart. And I hope it'll bless you this morning as we read this, okay? I'm going to be reading from Hebrews 10, 19 through 25. And just, it's a passage that we're familiar with, but it says it in a different way. So listen and hear from God this morning and be blessed. And so, dear brothers, now we may walk right in the very holy of holies where God is because of the blood of Jesus. This is the fresh, new, life-giving way which Christ has opened up for us by tearing the curtain, His human body, to let us into the holy presence of God. And since the great high priest of ours rules over God's household, let us go right in to God Himself with true hearts, fully trusting Him to receive us, because we have been sprinkled with Christ's blood to make us clean. And because our bodies have been washed with pure water. Now we can look forward to the salvation God has promised us. There is no longer any room for doubt, and we can tell others that salvation is ours. For there is no question that He will do what He says. In response to all He has done for us, let us outdo each other in being helpful and kind to each other and in doing good. Let us not neglect our church meetings, as some people do, but encourage and warn each other, especially now that the day of His coming back is drawing near. May God add His blessing to the reading of His word.
All right, well, if you could remain here, I'll turn on my mic here. We are thrilled to share with you that our brother Merle not only knows Christ, that's pretty obvious, isn't it? But he's been ordained into the gospel ministry out in Indianapolis, and we're glad that he found New York again. Amen. It's our belief, and Merle would agree with me, that he's been called by God into gospel ministry. What complete form that will take, only God knows entirely. He's preached in the pulpit for us. He's taught the Word of God in classes. He's traveled in his ministry with Bow Hunters of America, Christian Bow Hunters. And we're just thankful God in his goodness and providence brought Merle and Mitzi here to Yates for such a time as this. And he has been ordained. He's been examined by a godly council of men in the ministry and received full approval for his ordination. And so that is right now behind him. And before Merle may rest tremendous opportunities and avenue for ministry. God is expanding Merle's territory. It already is national. Maybe he'll go international. But we're delighted to have him as part of this congregation church family. I've asked some of our key men to come up with me this morning because we want to offer special prayer over Merle. I'm sure that occurred with you out in Indianapolis. I know the feel of ordination, been there and done it, and it's a wonderful, amazing moment. And so, guys, if you could join me, let's place our hands on Merle. Father, we are so thankful for the way you not only brought Merle to life in Christ, along with his wife Mitzi, but we're thankful, Lord, that you've called him into the gospel ministry. And as we are laying our hands upon him this morning, we pray that you would fill and anoint and use this dear man, this spirit-filled man, to reach many for Jesus Christ. Thank you for the way his messages have even edified and built up the people of God here and in many other places. And we ask that you would fall fresh upon him, lead him and guide him in the ministry that you would have him do. And we are excited over him and with him, and we pray for his protection as well. Lord, the Christian life's not a playground, it's a battleground. And we pray that, Father, you'd protect this dear man, be his shield and protector, he and his wife and family. And Lord, that you would lead him in amazing places where the seed of the gospel can be sown and watered and an abundant harvest as a result. Thank you, Lord, for Merle and his availability to your service. Thank you, we can be in the Lord's army. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, Merle. All right, do I understand there's a VBS song? All right. Don't forget our Sunday school hour, and that after a little snack time upstairs. Before I go much further, I would certainly like to say just a few words about the week that's transpired here. A vacation Bible school that, well, we, with Chris's help, we planned, organized, and did so rather in a hurried level. I think we shifted into overdrive, and Chris has worked hard. She's been a tremendous director. And we're deeply grateful. There is just so much to think about, staff to appoint and organize, set up, which is a job all by itself because there's all kinds of things and props that go up to announce the theme of VBS, clean up. While her and Sharon were putting in OT, getting things taken care of, and we're so thankful. And before I go any further, do we have a cordless mic here somewhere? There is. Bill, could we? Does anyone have anything they'd like to say about VBS? Yeah, Sharon.
This is one of the funniest things. We were packing up yesterday, and we, I don't know if you people that came in saw there was a blow-up train right as you entered. Well, it had to be deflated, and so Kent volunteered to do that, but in the process, he had to hold it down. He literally was hugging it on the floor, and his whole body was around this thing, and it wasn't going down because it was a second valve. The poor guy, he was totally encumbered by this thing. That was the funniest thing. Right.
We have wonderful actors in this congregation. If you ever seen Mr. Mike Miner up front, he's a hoot. Fabulous. I don't know if he's had acting lessons or not, but he was a joy to watch.
Amen. Thank you, Ray.
I'm thankful for Chris and for everyone that helped out. I have a lot of kids, and if someone hadn't taken it up, I would have been sad that my kids didn't get a chance to do VBS this summer, and so I'm forever grateful. Thank you, Chris, and everyone else that helped out.
Here we go.
We did have a whole week of organized chaos. I will say that was that. At our peak, we had 37 kids. I think everybody thoroughly enjoyed themselves. I had 25 to 30 helpers every night. So thank you so much. Everybody pulled together. We had a fantastic time. We learned a lot about God's word. We learned how Jesus' power helps us to get through a lot of different things. We took an offering. We had boys against the girls, of course. Offering, there were a lot of coins, and some of them counted forever. So the end total ended up to be that. Who won? The girls ended up winning, didn't they? The boys brought in $190.31, almost all change. And the girls brought in $266.98. And so the girls ended up winning, but we brought in $457.29, and we decided that it should go to the Gideons.
Amen.
The Gideons gave us Bibles this week that we can put in our backpacks or keep in our pockets because they're small. They've got places in them for us to write special verses and to sign if we've accepted Jesus as our Savior. So we had a wonderful week. Great helpers, good snacks. If every night when I ask what's your favorite part, it was games or snacks, but
snacks.
I believe that they did learn this week. And we do have a video clip for you so you can see some of the kids. Thank you. Thank you for all of your prayer support.
Amen. Amen. Oh, okay.
I'll say something because.
Sure.
I want to say this. I was really thankful for Janet Foster and Sharon doing the Bible lessons. I thought that's what we do the Vacation Bible School for. I will say this, also the coursers, Jacob and Karina, did the games and the freezes. That was, the kids loved that one. The snacks, the Johnsons really helped out with that. And Mrs. Kenyon really, like, just everyone did a great job helping out. But one of the things was, the very last day, Jacob and Karina had gone back to college, so we didn't have games for our group. and it was Pat Wilcox that said, let's just take that time, it's only 10 minutes, and make sure that all the kids hear the gospel, know the gospel.
Nice.
So our group, we were able to sit down and just, this is the kind of things I know you guys want to hear. We sat down and made sure that every kid heard the gospel as clear as we could to make, you know, a presentation there. Mm. Now, there were a lot of church kids and no one raised their hand. They're all peeking through their fingers and all that. But we just, everyone got a chance to hear the gospel clearly, and that's the purpose of EBS.
Praise the Lord. And so, that's exciting. That sounds like the leading of the Holy Spirit. That's good. Thanks, Mike. Appreciate that. We do have a VBS video for you right now.
We trust in you, Jesus. You're all, you're all, you're all that we need. Your power will pull us through. We're trusting in you, we're trusting in you. You give us hope and life that's forever. You make us bold and we stand together. This journey, there's no looking back. With Jesus to lead us, we're on the right track. Oh, 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 oh. Wide open spaces for wide open eyes. We're looking ahead for the next big surprise. Oh, 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 oh. We trust, we trust, we trust in you. Is for wide open eyes. We're looking ahead for the next big surprise. Oh, 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 oh. We trust, we trust, we trust in you, Jesus. You're all that we need. Your power will pull us through. We're trusting in you, we're trusting in you. You give us hope.
That's your short chance to get to know all the kids. And it continues. So I'm going to send around Children's Church. It hasn't gone around in a while because we had a whole bunch of people sign up to help. And we are all the way up to, I updated it, so it looks like October. So I'm giving you time to know your plans, and then I'll give you the lesson plans and all that and everything that's ready for it. But also, if somebody was really excited about family night and took the sign-up sheet home, could you bring it back? Because we don't know where that went. We're still in need of a couple of things. We want to start September 14th, the week after school starts. But we need help with teaching the boys' class. And again, I have all of the lessons and all of the stuff ready for you. And then some more help in with the youth would be good. We have a couple of people, but it's nice to be able to, if we have more adults, to be able to break up the groups of youth and do small things. And then we have lots of kitchen help, kitchen hands. But a lead person on it would be really great. We're going to be needing to, or someone also to volunteer. There's been a couple of different ideas too. Was also, if someone wants to just jump in once in a month somewhere and prepare the meal for that night, I can give you an idea. We have a little bit of a menu schedule, and you can pick one of those. Or like the week before Thanksgiving, I thought that would be nice if somebody came in and actually made like a nice meal for kids and stuff like that. Otherwise, we're going to rotate between some typical easy food things that the kitchen people can all help with and prepare and stuff like that. So that's some of the places where we need some help in those areas. So talk to me, catch up with me, or find the sign-up sheet. That could be really helpful, too. So thank you.
Thank you, Genoa. Let's grab our Bibles and look at Psalm 27. Psalm 27 for our morning scripture reading. David writes, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked came against me to eat up my flesh, my enemies and foes, they stumbled and fell. Though an army should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this I will be confident. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. He shall hide me. He shall set me high upon a rock. And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me. Therefore I will offer sacrifices of joy in his tabernacle. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Have mercy also upon me and answer me. When you said, 'Seek my face,' my heart said to you, 'Your face, Lord, will I seek.' Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my help. Do not leave me nor forsake me, O God of my salvation. When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take care of me. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in a smooth path because of my enemies. Do not deliver me to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and such as breathe out violence. I would have lost heart unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord." Amen. May God add his blessings to his word today. Ushers, if you could I saw this before we take up the offering today. Some of our young people are maybe have already gone off to college. I'm not sure, but college seems to start a little sooner. But a mother and father were chatting with their 13-year-old son about his future. The teenager said he'd like to attend Cornell, as his parents and other members of the family had. Pleased with his response, they pressed on. "What would you like to take when you attend college?" they asked the boy. After giving it some thought and glancing around the kitchen, he replied, "The refrigerator, if you can get along without it." Quite a major, huh? Well, praise the Lord. Father, we're so glad to be together. It's a beautiful day. We're so glad that you never will leave us nor forsake us. Thank you, Lord, for Merle. Thank you for what we've experienced thus far. VBS and how you met with us with all the children, providing everything needed to have a good and effective week. Thank you for what you're going to do in the remainder of the service. And as we take up this offering, we pray that we'd be ever mindful of him who loved us and gave his life upon the cross for our sin. And thank you, there is power in the blood. There's infinite power. There's inexhaustible power in the blood of Jesus Christ. And now bless as we give, be glorified in the offering. In Jesus' name, amen.
This train is bound for glory. This train. This train is bound for glory. This train. This train is bound for glory. Jesus made a place in heaven for me. This train is bound for glory. This train. This train is bound for glory. This train. This train. In heaven for me. This train is bound for glory. This train.
Okay, now let's bring it down.
This train is bound for glory. This train. This train is bound for glory. This train. This train is bound for glory. Jesus made a place in heaven for me. This train is bound for glory. This train. This train is bound for glory. This train. This train is bound for glory. This train. This train is bound for glory. Jesus made a place in heaven for me. This train is bound for glory. This train.
Good. You know, John, I thought of you about the train. Now, here's a brother that has ministered on trains. plays guitar, sang to passengers, children, and all week long I thought of my brother, our brother, whose train's been a big part of your life. Amen. Chattanooga Choo Choo down Tennessee. Thank you. Well, it's time to sing. Is Lori, do you want to? Go ahead, Well. I've got complete liberty. All right. 724. Lead on, O King Eternal.
Lead on, O King. Thy tents shall be.
You may be seated. Well, we're very, very thankful for God's goodness along the way. We're on the right path. Are you on the right path today? Are you following your Savior and King? Reading His Word each day? Today in our passage in Joshua 1, we're going to learn about the importance of this book of instructions. I remember some time ago we looked at that word Bible, B-I-B-L-E, and we came up with the statement, basic instructions before leaving Earth. I don't know if you could top that. That's pretty neat. And that's the way we should feel about our Bible. I pray we love God's Word. That we love the Lord. And we're going to learn today about our marching orders. And boy, I'll tell you, we need God's Word every day. We need to pray every day. We need to fellowship with others of like faith whenever, however we can. And certainly, last but not least, we need to tell others the good news of Jesus Christ and let people know that there is hope in Christ. Father, we pray now as we dig into the Word of God that You would guide our every step, our thoughts, what we say, how we act, our very behavior. May it speak well of our fellowship with You. The Bible tells us that the early apostles, when they were being watched, the Bible says they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. Father, may people look at us and observe our lifestyle and our priorities, and may they see that, Lord, we have been with You. May they see that we are Christians by our love, as it were. And Lord Jesus told us that if we love one another as You have loved us, that the whole world will know that we follow You, that we belong to You. And Lord, we're thankful that we can be heaven bound by faith in Jesus Christ. We indeed can be, as it were, on that glory train. And we're so very thankful that Jesus is that engineer. The letters on the engine are J-E-S-U-S. And we pray that we would indeed accept those tickets that have no cost to get on that amazing train. And Lord, we're thankful Jesus paid the full price for our salvation. May we never try to think that we can earn our way to heaven or to think that we can buy our way into heaven. It won't work. All the money in the world could never buy us a place in heaven. People may invest in multi-million dollar homes, but Lord, if they don't know Jesus, we know those homes will soon perish, including their own lives. We're thankful Jesus didn't come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. And so God, speak to us, even in this book of Joshua this morning. We are so thankful Ken and Kathy can be with us today. Thank You for Your healing hand and the grace that sustains us each day. And God, we're grateful for everybody that could make it out this morning. We believe, again, as Merle said earlier, we're here not by any sense of coincidence. We're here because You brought us here. And there's a message we need to listen to today. And I pray that Your Word will be clear, that Your Word will accomplish what You please and prosper in the thing whereto You have sent it. And so thank You, Lord, for meeting with us today. Thank You for a joyful VBS week. Thank You for raising Chris up. And Lord, prompting her to take the plow and Lord, not to look back, but to keep plowing ahead and forward. We're grateful that with hard work and looking to you in simple trust, that, Lord, you put together an amazing week. And we know that we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of you, not of us. And so, God, guide us now. May your Holy Spirit teach us. May we be teachable. May we listen. May we pay attention. And, Lord, not miss the blessing and miss out on our marching orders today. Thank you for all your love for us. Help us as a country to seek your face. I pray New York State would be turned right side up. The early disciples were accused of turning Jerusalem upside down. But Lord, just the opposite is true. The world's wisdom, it'll come to nothing. But your wisdom indeed will endure forever. And so help us in this venture. And Father, may we take personal responsibility to make sure people have an opportunity to hear the good news of Christ. Now direct our steps, and thank you for meeting with us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Joshua chapter 1 in your Bibles today. Joshua 1, verses 1 to 9, and it will be our passage of Scripture today. I noticed this about John Bunyan. Who remembers who John Bunyan is? He's not a cousin to Paul Bunyan. Good English preacher. Put in jail for the gospel, Bedford Prison in England. He wrote what book? Pilgrim's Progress. A tremendous Christian classic. But I understand John Bunyan had written in the front of his Bible on the flyleaf, "This book," which is the Bible, "this book will keep you from sin, or sin will keep you from this book." May we learn to keep this piece of wisdom seriously. I think if there's great needs among God's people today as never before, we need to give serious attention to what the Bible teaches. And we need to be open to the Holy Spirit to be taught properly. The best teacher I ever had and have is the Holy Spirit. I've had good teachers, and I've sat at the feet of tremendous men of God through the years. But ultimately, the best teacher is also the author of this book. Okay? The Holy Spirit moved upon the hearts of men to write down without any fault or error the very Word of God. And praise God, we have His Word in our own language. I pray as a church, as we get involved with missionaries and learn of what they're doing, we won't take for granted that we've got all the Bible, all of it, all 66 books in the English language. And we abound in English Bibles today. Brother Merle, Living Bible, Kenneth Taylor, the work he did to put that paraphrase together. We are greatly enriched and stocked in English Bibles, but there are many tribal groups and language groups and people groups out there that don't have one single book of the Bible in their own language. They've never heard the name Jesus before. They've never heard the gospel. And we here in America, we are just so blessed to be exposed to the Word of God, especially in a day and age when truth, as we know it and believe it, is taking a tremendous hit today. Our culture is just saturated with deceit and lies. Why? Because our culture is governed by the God of this age. I don't know any other explanation for it, but it's the way it is. We used to be viewed as a Christian nation. America, like Europe and England of old, used to send out missionaries all over the place. Right now, our churches not only are not sending out missionaries the way they used to, but many of our churches have taken this and set it aside and are now turning away their ears, amen, They're turning away their ears from the truth and turning unto myths, believe it or not. That's what's happening in churches. I read something startling in my email this past week. And you can take this for whatever it's worth, but this is a reality check, if there ever was a reality check. I learned, and I don't know where they get all their stats from and numbers, but that's okay. I don't need to know, really. But the email said there are 1,700 pastors leaving the ministry every month. Think about that for a moment. 1,700 pastors leaving the ministry every month. That adds up in a year, doesn't it? This is what's happening, folks. God help us. God lead us. May we realize we need Him every second with every breath we take in. We need Him. We need His Word. We need each other as the body of Christ. Joshua 1:1-9. The Bible says, "Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spake to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all this people, unto the land which I do give to them, even to the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and unto the great sea, toward the going down of the sun, shall be your coast. There shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. I will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. Be strong and of good courage, for unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever thou goest." Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 to 9. Just some points on your guide sheet. If you should have one tucked away in your newsletter and program there, our marching orders. First of all, I think it's pretty obvious that Joshua became Moses' successor by divine appointment. Joshua became Moses' successor by divine appointment, according to verses 1 and 2. Chapter 34 of Deuteronomy gets into the very death of Moses. You know what was unusual about that? Guess who his mortician was? The Lord. The Lord buried Moses. But Moses could not enter the promised land due to his disobedience and anger. And we may think that was rather harsh judgment on Moses. He really wanted to go in, but the Lord would not allow him. He had a chance to view the promised land from the mountaintop, but to go in, God had been preparing Joshua all along. And it's important to remember that Joshua, Jehoshua, or Yeshua, and Jesus mean the same thing. Okay? Jehovah Savior. Jehovah Savior. Joshua became his successor by divine appointment. I want you to notice in our verses here also the importance of servant leadership. The Bible has a lot to say about Christian leadership. And we know that the Scriptures always bring out that important principle, leading by serving. Didn't Jesus say even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto or to be served, but to serve? Even the Son of Man came to serve. If He came to serve, where does that put us? Even in leadership today, whether we're a missionary, evangelist, or pastor, or whatever our leadership role may be, the best way to lead is by serving. Jesus set the tone for us there. Joshua, the Bible tells us, was full of the spirit of wisdom. For Moses had laid his hands upon him. Isn't that something? Moses had become aware of this young man who had served Moses, many believe, for at least 40 years. Think of that. 40 years of service. And before Moses died, he placed his hands on Joshua. What's the significance of this? Well, Brother Merle, he needed the Holy Spirit. He was anointed by God to lead the children of Israel into the promised land. But they had to cross that Jordan River first, didn't they? The Lord says, okay, I'll take care of that. We know what the Bible says. God dried up the river, and across they went. Right? Joshua led the way. But Moses laid his hands on Joshua, and this really is a symbol of how the Holy Spirit would lead and guide and empower Joshua for this God-given task. What an amazing responsibility. Many believe that even though there was a generation that died off in the 40 years of wandering the wilderness, that Joshua still had about 2 million people to lead across the Jordan that day. There's nothing like leadership by divine appointment, and boy, I'll tell you, this is so vital to the work of the gospel indeed. Secondly, we see the opening chapter of Joshua teaches us the law of appropriation. Now, there's a million-dollar word, amen? What's the law of appropriation? I mentioned here that our relationship to God is a give-and-take relationship. You might wonder, what in the world is that all about? Well, in Joshua 1, it's repeated a number of times, God gave the children of Israel this promised land. He surrendered the title to Israel, and this would be their inheritance. Okay? But here's the point, and this is something that the Pilgrim Study Bible says. God gave the land to Israel in promise. God swore to give them the land by means of a divine oath. God gave the land to Israel. It only became theirs in reality when they took possession of it. You kind of get the drift? God says, here's the land. I've given it to you. Now go in and claim it by faith. Remember the 12 spies? How many came back and said, let's go? Two out of 12. That's quite a story, isn't it? Joshua, Caleb. If you look at Numbers chapter 13 and verse 30, this is what Caleb did. Man, 10 of the 12 came back and says, man, the land is wonderful, it's great, but man, we've got problems on our hands. There's giants in that land. We're not able. We have no prayer against these guys. But the Bible says Caleb stilled the people before Moses in Numbers 13:30, and he said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it. Oh, what an amazing thought here. We're well able to overcome. My friend, we face in a very real sense our own obstacles and negative things and giants and things that look imposing and intimidating. But in Jesus' name, in the name of Jesus, indeed, we are well able to overcome, as David did Goliath, that giant that stands in our path, okay? And we can be overcomers rather than being overcome by the enemy. The old Scofield Reference Bible, I don't have this on your guide sheet, but it has a very interesting marginal note. God gives, but we must take. God gives, but we must take. Let me just apply this now to the gospel and to salvation. God gave His only begotten Son. Right? God so loved the world, He gave us His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. On one hand, God gave us His Son. On our part, we must take Him in. We must receive Him. We must believe. We must turn from our sin and turn to Christ and realize He's the only one that can forgive our sin. He's the only one that can save us from sin, and we must take Him in. This is appropriation. Okay? This is what appropriation is all about here. You know, the Scriptures tell us in Ephesians chapter 1, someone once said it's good to read Joshua in the Old Testament and read Ephesians in the New Testament. I think that's good advice, because Ephesians 1:11 says, in Christ, now, we have obtained an inheritance. Now, isn't that interesting? Israel had their land. What's our inheritance? The Bible says in heaven, we have an inheritance that's incorruptible, undefiled, and will never fade away. 1 Peter. Amazing, is it not? Do you realize the Bible says, Romans 8, we are heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, His dear Son? But we must claim this and receive it by faith. God had issued a promise to Israel. I've given you the land. Now go in and possess. One Bible writer said, it's amazing how much we really own in Christ, but how little we possess. It's an interesting thought. The law of appropriation. Be strong and of good courage. I looked over Joshua 1. That's given at least 4 times in the chapter. Anytime anything is repeated, please, when you're reading and studying your Bible, take note of things, Bible words, phrases, sentences that are repeated. The Lord is trying to get across something there. There's a sense of value. Here it is. And He repeats it and repeats it and repeats it. You know, I find often I'm on the receiving end of a lot of repetition because things slip through my fingers and I need to be reminded. Is this not why we do communion in remembrance of who He is, what He did for us on the cross? Thirdly, we need to allow the Word of God to become a genuine, all-consuming part of our lifestyle by means of application. We need to allow the Word of God to become a genuine, all-consuming part of our lifestyle by means of application. Verses 7 and 8 in our text have amazing things to say about the Word of God. It was key. The Word of God and their instructions there and their obedience were key to victory in the Promised Land. Without the Word, without God's assurance, they never would have succeeded. But we are to be quick to hear the Word of God, for one thing. I find that listening is an amazing art and skill. God is speaking. Am I listening? James 1:19. Are you familiar with that? Let every man be swift to talk. Yeah, you got it. Swift to hear, slow to speak. You know how much wisdom there is in that? You realize what little stress, little trouble we would have if we would be slow to speak? That's hard for us extroverts, let me tell you. You know what I mean by extrovert. Be quick to hear, quick and ready and eager to listen to what God has to say. Because you look at that thought in its context, it's talking about the word of truth. Be quick to hear and listen to what God is trying to tell you. Quick to hear. That's the first part. Secondly, we're to be quick to receive. We're to be quick to receive the word of God. James says, receive with meekness the engrafted or the implanted word which is able to save your souls. And obviously we're to be quick to do or obey the word of God. What's it say there? Be talkers of the word? Be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Oh, so important here. Joshua 1:8 is a good verse to look over carefully because it tells us what our relationship with God's word should be if our way is to be prosperous and if we are going to achieve good success. If I were to teach a seminar on how to be successful, I would not turn to a book on corporations and business and all that sort of thing. I would turn to Joshua 1:8. And I would teach Joshua 1:8 to anybody that wants to be successful in life. Think about that for a moment. Think of the secular world that has its own ideas of how to be successful, how to achieve, how to be Top Gun. You'll find that their wisdom and their advice and their counsel is not really very scriptural. But the Bible tells us how to be successful, and that's to really let the Word of God become a part of what we say. We need to meditate on the Word of God every day. Think about what it's really saying. I have no doubt that reading God's Word is where it begins. We've got to open up our Bible. Read it. Think about what you're reading. Take a verse of the Bible. Take it apart phrase by phrase. Analyze a verse. Ponder it over. That's what I love about Mary in the New Testament, Mother of Jesus. She pondered over, treasured in her heart, the things that were said to her when Jesus was about to be born. Oh, how we need to meditate. Look over Psalm 1 sometime. Amazing psalm about the importance of meditating on the Word of God day and night. And the Bible says we'll be like that fruitful tree in the psalm there. Finally, this, we need to express sincere appreciation to God for His abiding presence and sweet assurances. According to verse 9, have not I commanded thee? I thought of that sentence in verse 9. You know where I put the emphasis? What's it say? Have not I commanded thee? I'm not a mere man. I'm the Lord God. I brought you out of Egypt from your slavery and bondage. You are mine. Have not I commanded thee? It goes back to that matter that we as believers live under divine command. And if we grasp this and take hold of it seriously, and give divine authority the place it deserves, I believe that we can march forward and be successful and reach people for Christ. But the very moment we get out from under divine authority and that divine umbrella, we become easy prey for Satan, the world, the flesh, you name it. We must remain under that divine umbrella and place His Word as our final rule for faith and practice. How can we do it? There's only one answer I can give you. It can only be done through the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. Right? If any man have not the Spirit of Christ, Romans 8, he is none of His. It doesn't say there, if you don't have the Holy Spirit, you're half His. It says we're none of His if we don't have the Holy Spirit. How can I have the Holy Spirit? By coming to the foot of the cross, reaching out to Jesus, and just simply like Peter of old, pray, Lord, save me. You know what will happen? The Spirit of Christ will take up residence in your heart. And He will be there to stay. He will never, ever leave you or forsake you. The very promise God gave to the children of Israel through Joshua is the promise we have today. Jesus said, all authority has been given unto me in heaven and earth. Go ye therefore. Disciple every language, every dialect, every people group on planet earth. Go out and tell them. Share the gospel to every creature. Make disciples, teaching them to observe everything I've commanded you. What did He say? Lo, I am with you. I'm with you. How long? To the end of the age. Right to the very end of the age. I'm with you wherever you go. Listen to my instructions carefully. Obey my instructions, and you will keep marching on. You will overcome. You will be successful, and all glory and praise will go to God who made it all happen in the first place. Now, I got VBS fever, Chris, at the end of this. Right? God's power will pull us through. Amen? Father, we serve an awesome, mighty God. Thank you for giving us Jesus. You couldn't have given us a better gift. Paul says He's that unspeakable, inexpressible gift. Father, if there's someone here today that does not know Jesus, please, Lord, draw them to Yourself. It isn't complicated. It's something a little child can do. By saying yes to Jesus, opening up our heart and life to Christ. And God, if our heart is empty, indeed, it can be filled to overflowing. So guide and thank You for this book of Joshua, this book of conquest. May we indeed realize that in Christ, we are more than conquerors through Him that loved us and gave Himself up for us. Guide as we sing to You now. And Lord, as we deal with a very important question, we pray that we would be able by Thy grace to answer it. And Lord, to be on the right team, the winning team, the true champions. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's grab our hymnal to number 674. Who is on the Lord's side? may we take this to heart, dear Lord. We can't be fence straddlers. The Bible says we're either your friend or we're the world's friend. Father, help us to choose. Help us to choose this day who we will serve. And thank you, we can be overcomers in Jesus' name, not with guns, not with weapons that this world would exalt, but Lord, through love and the truth and prayer, we can see people's lives changed forever. Guide us with your blessing, and thank you for meeting with us in a special day. In Jesus' name, amen.